7, so we'll kick things off this evening. Welcome to everyone. I'll just do a bit of introductory and admin stuff whilst a few more people still sign on. I can see the numbers clicking up as I speak. This evening's session is all about how to put together a good LinkedIn profile and then how to use that and get the most out of it. The broadcast itself is one-way audio only, so it doesn't matter how you've got your computer set up, whether you've got a webcam, speakers, microphone. The only thing that you should be able to see and hear is the slides visually on your screen and my dulcet tones over the Ethernet. And as far as seeing me, I'm afraid you can't do that either. It's just an audio one-way broadcast. So in terms of handling any questions that you might have, the best way is to type them into the facility you have on your GoToWebinar toolbar at any time during the session. Just rattle any questions or comments you've got. And then towards the end of the session, I'll let you know that we're done. Those that need to disappear can make their way and go off and do whatever they need to do. But if you want to listen to the answers either to your own questions or those of others, you're more than welcome to hang on. And what I try to do every webinar is to answer all the questions in turn. There's quite a few on this evening, so whether that's a realistic aim or not, only time will tell. So as I say, towards the end of the session, I'll let you know when we've finished with the main content. Those that need to disappear can. Those that want to listen to the answers to any questions, more than welcome to hang on. And then I'll let you know when we're done with the questions and answers. As far as this evening's content's concerned, if you saw the invite that you got when you signed on, we're going to cover quite a few things. LinkedIn is a very complex beast at the best of times. Lots of functionality, lots of things you can do with it, lots of things that others can do with your profile in terms of visibility and searching. We can't cover everything, but we can cover the most important things, the things that if you get right and if you sort, will make a big difference to how people interpret what you're about, how they'll find you in the first place, and materially impact on your success at getting interviews, or at least reinforcing a positive view that you might have generated with your CV or some form of job application. We'll also touch on a few things, I have to say, that if you get it wrong, could materially affect negatively your chances of getting an interview, irrespective of your application or CV. So there's sort of do's and don'ts of having an effective LinkedIn profile. And there are probably going to be a fair few references to the CV. Most people tend to use their CV as a basis for their LinkedIn profile, and there's some logical and good things about that, but there's also some pitfalls as well, which we'll address. So quite a lot to fit into the hour that we have. Very briefly, in terms of who on earth we are, we're obviously a partner with ACCA Careers. Our business is called CV and Interview Advisors. We've partnered with the ACCA for some years now as far as providing career and CV advice. And we do that within the UK for a variety of people. The team here, and the reason I mention this is really just to give you some comfort, hopefully, that what we say, the things that we do, the things that we preach, but more importantly, the things that we actually put into practice for our clients, whether they're members of ACCA or not, do actually work, and they work partly because our backgrounds are from recruitment, senior roles, be that in recruitment or employers, and we know our stuff. And we see it from a lot of different angles. So finance and IT tend to be strength areas of ours, but we write CVs and deal with LinkedIn profiles for pretty much anybody under the sun. So we see how these things get used. We know how recruiters use these tools and how they interpret the information that you're sending them. And then we can take a really good view, an overview of what's going on in the market at any particular moment in time. My own background, just so you know, is that in my early career I worked in corporate life and I've recruited people as an employer. For my sins, I've then been in recruitment as a job, and then more latterly I've reviewed CVs for the guys that run the business here at CV and Interview Advisors, and I've written a fair few CVs as well, and that includes finance. As I said, we work closely with ACCA and provide a lot of the support on the webinars and career advice. And we're resident experts to a lot of other chartered institutes and membership organisations as well. So again, at the very least, however impressed or otherwise you might be with that statement, the reality is we collect an awful lot of information about what's going on in the marketplace. And it's amazing how much of a clear view that gives you about what works and what doesn't. And so that's the key thing. The bottom line is that we're providing material collateral, if you like, to our clients, be that CV or a LinkedIn profile or interview coaching advice, that materially makes a difference to getting interviews. Now, a lot of people ask us, and it's a fair question, what kind of difference might it make to get your CV and LinkedIn profile properly sorted? And what I mean by properly sorted is a lot of what we're going to talk about this evening. It doesn't really matter who does it. It's more about the message you're sending to your target audience. And there's a few phrases that I'll be using quite a lot of this evening, I suspect, target audience being one of them. It's really important that whatever you do as regards your, whether you're applying for jobs actively, whether you're building a profile for future use and trying to gain credibility in a marketplace that might be useful for you in 6, 9, 12, 24 months' time, if you have in mind what your target audience is expecting to see and what will interest them, that will make your job a lot easier. If you don't understand what's going through their mind, life becomes a lot harder, particularly when you start applying for jobs. Now, we typically, it's a bit hard because everybody's different, but on average, we see a significant double-digit increase, i.e. somewhere between 30 and 50% on average, increase in interview rate that people get once they've sorted their CV and to some degree their LinkedIn profile out. That's how dramatic it can be. There was one guy that we talked with last week who'd attended one of our webinars who'd actually had very little interest in 3 years of applying for jobs and just started to get their CV and LinkedIn profile sorted, all of a sudden getting interviews literally overnight. It can be that black and white and that big a difference. So enough about us, but I guess the message I wanted to get across is, you know, please take what we have to say as not being gospel necessarily, but it can materially make a difference. It does help. It's not just smoke and mirrors, bluff and blunder. It's practical advice. And if you put stuff into practice, and particularly the stuff I talk about this evening, and you're experiencing troubles right now in the job marketplace, if you get it right, it will make a material difference to your success, almost guaranteed. Get it wrong, and I can definitely guarantee things won't get any better. Very briefly, what on earth is LinkedIn? I have to acknowledge the fact that every webinar we run, we have a variety of people, and I would encourage you during the session this evening to sort of reflect and think about how you're treating your profile and the message you're sending your target audience right now. I can't deal with everybody's situation, of course, but I have to take sort of a working average. And so I know tonight we'll have some people maybe don't even have a LinkedIn profile right now, might not even know much about what LinkedIn is, right the way through to people who are quite active on LinkedIn and use it a lot. And so I have to sort of plow a trough through that and get a reasonably good average. So that's what I'll have to do. So for the benefit of people who don't know what LinkedIn is or are maybe confused by it, it is generally seen as being a professional networking site. So it's not a Facebook, it's not a Twitter. It is, generally speaking, a place where you'd expect to find professionals with relatively similar thoughts. It's rapidly expanding. I forget what a year ago the members were, but they were certainly well south of 200 million. They're above 230 right now and climbing, and of course it's a global operation, give or take. Importantly, one of the reasons why people don't use LinkedIn or are suspicious of it is that they probably take too close a view. Now, there are a few exceptions to this, genuine exceptions, but a lot of people say to us, well, you know, I'm worried if I have a LinkedIn profile, I start messing around with it, changing it, amending it, it will naturally give the game away that I'm looking to move. And so one of the myths I'd like to try and dispel, unless you've got absolute cast iron proof that that would cause you problems with your current employer, is that LinkedIn's being used by a vast variety of people for all sorts of different reasons, some of which I'm putting onto the slide right now. So I guess most people tend to see it as being a place where you can find out information about jobs, employers, and opportunities. But just bear in mind, there are an awful lot of people using it to do genuine research. There are, of course, recruiters and hiring managers looking for candidates, not just candidates looking for jobs. There are entrepreneurs out there looking to increase their own profile and showcase their talents and abilities and products and businesses. And there are salespeople out there or anybody involved in business development, purchasing, any commercial transactions, sussing out businesses, individuals, companies, organizations, associations, whatever. So there are a whole host of people out there using LinkedIn for a variety of reasons, not just about job hunting, which is important because although LinkedIn does make most of its money from selling subscriptions to recruiters and employers, it doesn't necessarily mean that's what people are on it for. In fact, one of the beauties of LinkedIn is that it's not seen yet anyway as a pure job board. In fact, a lot of people are surprised when they find out how much money LinkedIn does get from recruiters. So if you're concerned about using LinkedIn as a means to attract an opportunity or to promote your interest, then what we'll cover this evening will hopefully dispel that myth to some degree, because the style and approach that you take on your profile can quite subtly deal with whether you're actively looking or not in the job market. And our view is, and the view that seems to be most effective, is that you don't need to go guns a-blazing. Look at me, I'm looking for a job, I'm available, I'm immediately or otherwise, I'm seeking an opportunity. That approach is not productive anyway, generally speaking. So if you have any concerns about being on LinkedIn and what it says to the wider world, I would say don't be, unless you've got a very strong reason or proof to dispel that view. We're going to focus, I guess, mainly on the fact that realistically most people will be wanting to learn about how they can maximize their chances of being noticed in the world. So we'll focus on the job-seeking element because that's what most people are interested in as individuals and how you can influence that process. To reinforce the fact that I mentioned on the previous slide, the revenues that LinkedIn generate from recruiters and employers who use it primarily to source talent, obviously very high. They're the largest chunk of revenues that LinkedIn earn. The other interesting fact at the bottom of this slide is that more people found a job through LinkedIn in 2012 than they did via monster.com, which is, if not the biggest, one of the biggest job sites in the world. Again, not many people know that, but it reinforces the fact that if you're actively looking to build a profile or to get opportunities, you really ought to be considering LinkedIn as a vehicle. Now, you can use it in a number of proactive ways, as well as being LinkedIn being a reactive tool for you. So we'll just quickly look at some of these examples. Again, some people who've got a profile will have actively dabbled in this to some degree or not. Others may not even have tried. But at the base level, you can find jobs on LinkedIn. There is a section normally at the top of your screen when you're in your LinkedIn profile, clearly marked jobs. Just click on it and then follow the threads. And so it's quite possible for an individual with a profile to jump onto LinkedIn, search for jobs, and then apply through that mechanism. Of course, once you've identified a company that you're interested in, you might have people in your own network who might be able to shed some light on that, so it becomes quite a powerful tool. If you don't search for jobs per se, you can search for target companies that you're interested in, and again, see whether there's anybody in your network that already works there or has some knowledge of that organization. One level up again, you can search for people involved in the decision-making process as far as your career is concerned. So that could be people within companies, recruiters, groups or associations that are linked to your interest areas, and seek to try and build and add them to your own network. So from being a purely reactive tool in the sense that you can apply for a job like a traditional job board, you can use it to actually gain knowledge or to put yourself in a better position for the future merely by looking to see who you can add to your network or who already may be in your network to some degree or other. You can use other people within your network to find other people who might be a step closer to them, again, to get introduced and build a relationship. So can be quite useful in that regard. And then if you're really into using LinkedIn and making it work for you, you can participate in the various discussion groups that exist and become a, if not an expert, somebody who could answer questions for others or provide answers to questions for others and able to build your credibility in a certain area. And that depends on who you are and what you want to do with it. All of these things are possible. They're not necessarily essential to you getting noticed per se. They're not necessarily essential to something that you have to do day in, day out. And one of the things about LinkedIn is that you could have a profile, and as long as it's accurate and powerful in the way that I'll be describing shortly, you could just leave it sit there for a year. And as long as your career doesn't change materially, it will do you no harm. But if you do want to make it more valuable and proactive as far as your job seeking objectives are concerned, there is a whole heap of things you can do to improve your chances of being noticed, and these are just some of them. So you can actively search for jobs, that's the easy bit. The more complex bit is using LinkedIn's power to find people or companies or people within companies that are of interest to you and work out how you might be able to connect with them either directly or through others. And that's where it becomes a really powerful tool, should you want to use it. I guess most people are on LinkedIn because they hope somebody might notice them. And so one other interesting factor is to reinforce how important it could become if you're not already convinced is that this text that's just gone on the screen towards the bottom of the slide, this is a recent announcement. I think it's actually a couple of Thursdays ago now, but I'm sort of quoting literally from the press release. But it really just surrounds LinkedIn having spent quite a lot of money on a specialist company that, like many of these specialist companies these days, write algorithms for use on websites to make things easier or automate processes. In this case, LinkedIn's acquired a business that will allow it to become much cleverer at linking people to employers. Now, they wouldn't have spent $100-odd million if they didn't think this was going to be recouped in some way. And so it does point to the fact that LinkedIn's just going to get stronger and stronger as a vehicle to link folk with companies looking for talent. So again, it just reinforces the fact that this is going to become their core purpose by and large. And you can take advantage of it if your profile is in a decent state. So let's take a look at the profile itself and some of the things you should be doing. So the backdrop to this is, let's assume if you've got a LinkedIn profile right now, some of the things I'm going to talk about, you need to start thinking and reflecting on whether you are close to this or not, which will then help form a decision on whether you need to take any action or not. And if you need to take some action, then the detail of what I'll be talking about later will help you fill in some of the gaps and have a stronger profile. And even if then that becomes too much of an issue for you and you want somebody to help you out, then of course there are ways and means of getting others involved to helping the cause and providing a solution for you. Most people, as I hinted at right at the beginning of this presentation, they tend to start with their current CV and dump it into LinkedIn. And many people think, well, that's it. In fact, LinkedIn even can encourage that. It can automate that process and sort of hoover in the data from your CV and fill out various forms on LinkedIn. And there's a good chunk of people we deal with who think that's perfectly acceptable. Maybe they can do it on a Sunday afternoon, couple of minutes, just shooting their CV, open up their profile, fill in the fields, job done, got a LinkedIn profile, yeah, the world's going to be a better place. And for some people, in fairness, that might work. But it does presuppose, of course, that your CV is actually an effective tool already. If it isn't, guess what? All you're doing is duplicating a problem. So one of the first things to reflect on and to start digging deeper into your own soul, if you like, and ask the question is your CV any good? Now, when we talk to people about their CVs specifically, the tool we try and get people to use as a bit of a self-analysis is what we call the acid test. And for us, that's how effective the CV is at getting you interviews for jobs that you've applied for. So if you are now active in the marketplace or have recently been active in the job marketplace, And let's say you've applied for 10 jobs just because the maths is easy, and you've got zero interviews or one or two or three interviews out of those 10 jobs, and it's jobs that you know you could perform, you've got some kind of problem with the CV, would be my comment. Now, that may seem fairly confrontational in some regards, and you might dispute that, but the harsh reality is if you're not getting interviews for jobs that you know you could perform, merely by sending off your CV or filling out an application form, I can virtually guarantee the message you're sending your target audience is not what they want to see, and that's why you're not getting the interviews. It's quite a harsh statistic, but it's real. The downside is, with all this, is that very rarely do people get told that. So it's highly unlikely, when it's almost impossible, the employer will tell you to your face that your CV's atrocious or a reason for not interviewing you. The recruiter, if you're dealing with one, is probably unlikely to say that. They may, but they're unlikely to say that. Most people will find the easy way out and say, there are more people with stronger skills. You're either underqualified, overqualified. There are lots of applicants. We found somebody slightly closer to the brief. All sorts of what seem like plausible reasons. But if you know, hand on heart, you could have done that job, and you're puzzled as to why you didn't get an interview, I can virtually guarantee you 99 times out of 100, it will be because the CV is not strong enough. Now, the problem for a lot of people is that now LinkedIn exists, and it's such a prevalent tool. If you've sent your CV or application form off for a job, people will suss you out on LinkedIn before they decide to interview you. The vast majority, in fact, will do that. And so if the message on your CV is the same and it's not a good CV, as I said earlier, it's harming your prospects. Worse still, there's a surprising number of people who come to us for help and their CV and LinkedIn differ, sometimes markedly. The subtle differences are normally the message isn't quite the same, and the very obvious, not so subtle differences are the dates are different, the job titles are different, the layout's different, the whole message is different. And often people are just too close to it to see the problem they're causing themselves. And so LinkedIn, in some regards, for people with a bad CV who've then opened up a LinkedIn profile, LinkedIn's not been good for them because it's just replicating the badness, so to speak. So that stat, if you've got it, is a crucial indicator because that really does help you decide whether you've got a problem or not. Forget for a moment what you've been told. Just look at the hard math. Applied for 10 jobs, got zero interviews, or one or two or three out of the 10, guarantee you it's a problem with the CV. If you're getting 8, 9, 10 interviews out of the 10, to be honest, you've not got a problem, obviously. You're getting a healthy number of interviews. If your problem lies elsewhere, are you still not getting job offers with that kind of hit ratio, there's something else going wrong, but I can virtually guarantee it isn't the CV or the LinkedIn profile. So armed with that stat, unsurprisingly, we've got a view on how you therefore should go to market, and this again, it's not particularly clever, but it's surprising how many people don't get this on their current documents. You've got to go to market. You've got to present your target audience with an effective business case as to why they should hire you. Now, most of you are involved in finance in some way or other. Depending on your level of seniority, you will have either had to go and ask somebody for some money at some point in your life, or potentially you're somebody who signs off on giving somebody some money. Those things tend not to happen on a whim or a suggestion. So people don't roll up to their boss one day and say, I need £1 million to invest in this new piece of plant or IT because I think it's a great idea. And certainly the person on the other side of that message is unlikely to say, great, here's the check, or I've just wired over the money, or I've just created a deposit in your account or your department's account to go off and spend that £1 million. Those things just don't happen. To get any spend these days, you have to provide that person or that body or that department with some proof, some evidence to support a case as to why they should invest the money. And you have to view yourself a bit like that in the marketplace. You are a product, a service, a tool to a problem. Somebody's got a problem. They're prepared to invest a certain amount of money in it, i.e. your salary or remuneration. What are you going to offer in return? You've got to make sure the CV and LinkedIn profile give some meat on the bone. What return are you going to offer to the business as a consequence of them having employed you? And if that case isn't strong enough, there's a significant risk of you not getting interviews. And it's that brutal. And things have moved on a lot since 25, 30 years ago, where you could just send somebody a list of stuff and you might get an interview. It's not like that now. You have to provide a pretty strong business case to your target audience as to why they're going to be interested in you. Then you might stand to get an interview. So that's the biggest change you can make at a macro level. So if your CV currently and your LinkedIn profile, therefore, is just a list of stuff, places you've worked, jobs that you've had, duties and responsibilities within those jobs, how people can contact you, hobbies and interests, just merely in list fashion, I can virtually guarantee you'll have a tough time in the marketplace, both now and in the future. And if you know that that's the case and you've already experienced those problems, that's partly where the problem lies. If you switch that and start to make a stronger business case, as a result of employing me, Mr. or Mrs. Employer, you stand to gain these benefits, and here's the proof to back it up, making a strong business case, in other words, I can virtually guarantee you'll have a much easier time in the marketplace and you'll certainly get more interviews. So, biggest message of all this evening, irrespective of whether it's your CV or LinkedIn profile, but the two are almost inextricably linked, of course, is that a bad version, bad message is one that's just a list of stuff. A good one is one that presents a business case. So if you start asking yourself the question now, does my CV and LinkedIn profile present a business case to my target audience? If you answer yes, then great. If you know what I mean, if you're thinking, well, I'm not really sure what a business case is, we'll go into that shortly. And if you know actually that you're not presenting a business case at all, i.e. there's no logical argument as why somebody should hire you, then I'd say it starts again to help you make a decision on, I need to do something about this. So I'm going to talk about three things now as far as your LinkedIn profile that will make a material difference and build this business case that I'm going on about. To get these three things right, it will make a difference. First one is the professional headline in LinkedIn. And some people will say, well, what on earth's the professional headline and where is it? And we'll take a look at that very shortly. But what this should be, and incidentally, it's the piece of text, we will look at a real life example shortly, but it's a piece of text that appears under your name on your LinkedIn profile. That needs to be, and again, a bit of a cliche, I'm afraid, but it needs to be your value proposition. And you might say, well, what is my value proposition, or what does value proposition mean? Well, it is a bit of a cliche, but it's the best way of describing this value add that you've got. So as a consequence of somebody employing you, what is the main benefit they're going to get as a consequence of that? We'll come on to this shortly and to how to build that up. What you shouldn't do, and this is often the case, I'm afraid, with LinkedIn, is go with LinkedIn's default setting. So if any of you have set up your own profile recently and you remember this, when you enter in your employment and you select the option that in effect says, this is my most recent job, this is where I'm currently working, and there's a little tick box for that. As soon as you make that selection, LinkedIn, being the clever old thing that it is, will suggest, okay, well, thanks very much for that. You're currently hypothetically finance director at XYZ PLC. Shall I use that information in your professional headline? And most people think, oh, that's really helpful of you, LinkedIn. Thanks very much. Yes, I'll go with that because it saves me. That takes a little bit less time to complete my profile. That must be right because LinkedIn's offering that option. Therefore, yes, I will select it. And for some people, it's not such a big deal. But it isn't really... it's not really differentiating you from anybody else. So for all those finance directors out there, or finance managers, or tax accountant, or management accountant, or payroll officer, or credit controller, whatever your title is, there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of those people with the same title lurking around in the UK, let alone further afield. So leading your profile on LinkedIn with your name and then something which thousands of other people share isn't that clever an idea, really, is it? It's not differentiating you. It's not giving the reader any sense of what you have to offer this world. It's just saying what you are. And the trouble is, what you are is shared by many, many other people. So we would encourage you to remove the default option from that part of LinkedIn and go with something more akin to what's just appeared on the screen, which could, obviously it's personalized, it has to be relevant to your own set of skills and abilities, and we'll look at this shortly. But in effect, it's much more productive to say, rather than just I am finance director at XYZ PLC, an experienced finance director with a track record of protecting cash flow and profitability, it hints at what you're good at. Now, obviously, for different people, it'll say different things, and your value proposition may be unique, or it may be completely different from protecting cash flow and profitability. That's not the point. The point is the message being said for this particular individual, who at the end of the day is exactly the same individual, is a whole lot more productive if you actually describe what you might be good at, what you might be offering in return for the thousands of pounds of remuneration you'll be earning every year. So that is the first thing. It's a very subtle thing. Most people haven't got this. Most people have got either their current job title or company, or they've overwritten that with something like immediately available or currently seeking opportunities, or even some people unemployed. None of those things are that productive. LinkedIn, at its ideal, is somewhere where you don't have to reveal exactly what your state is right now. In an ideal world, you ought to be creating a picture in the mind of the reader that you have the right skills and abilities to perform something that they're interested in you for, and that they ought to be thinking, I really hope this individual is available and interested in what I have to say as a recruiter or employer, not, oh, I see this person is actually desperately seeking something, so therefore I must be compelled to ring them. It doesn't work like that. Psychologically, people are put off by people who appear to be too keen to promote themselves via LinkedIn for a job. It just doesn't work. However desperate your situation may be, communicating that to the masses is not the way forward. So if you can convert your professional headline to something far more productive and constructive, it will automatically set a better scene for you and differentiate you from most of your competition. So I'll show you a real example. Matt's the guy that runs our business, and this is his LinkedIn profile as you would see it if you were in any way connected with him or taking a view of his public profile. The display was different slightly, but in a sense the information you'd see is exactly what you'd see if you were searching for him or able to see his profile via LinkedIn, whether you were connected with him or not. The professional headline is the bit that's highlighted with a nice big red oval, and it's a bit just under his name, so ND and Career Enhancements Leader, blah, 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 blah. So what he's stating there, yes, okay, he's describing that he's basically the guy that runs the business, but more importantly, his value proposition is that he can drive success in the job market. Now, that's relevant to his target audience, which are companies and individuals interested in enhancing how they perform within the job market. Okay, it's wholly better than just saying managing director at CVIA Group, which would mean virtually nothing to most people, and just puts him amongst all the other MDs lurking out there. So it's surprisingly simple. You can't type and type and type in this box. There is a limit, I think, to 120 characters, including spaces, so you have to keep it quite tight. But just changing this will give those people who are skim reading a whole wedge of profiles that they've searched for a much clearer view as to what you might be able to offer. If you get this bit right, you suddenly become a whole lot more attractive to the reader who's skim reading before they start looking at a few profiles in any depth. So just like the process with the CV, if your opening message on your CV is the right message, you'll be put aside, metaphorically speaking, into the maybe or the yes pile. If your message is generic and just waffles on about how wonderful you are, which isn't actually what the recruiter's wanting to see, chances are that would get put in the no pile pretty quickly. So you're just trying to get people to look at the profile and think, yes, this is relevant, probably somebody I need to take a little bit more detailed look at. Okay, so that's the first area of three that I mentioned would make the biggest difference. Second area, the summary, LinkedIn summary, that is. And in here, perhaps probably the greatest mistake people tend to make is because it's very easy to copy and paste from your existing CV. If you've got anything in your CV currently, and again, a moment of reflection, or on your LinkedIn profile, which in effect just tells people, as I hinted at earlier, that you are wonderful, you've got great interpersonal skills, you can work well as an individual or as in a team, that you're enthusiastic, dynamic, passionate, committed, give 110%. If you've got any of that nonsense, I would encourage you tonight, if not tomorrow morning, to whip that out straight away, both from your CV and your LinkedIn profile. And the reason being is that they're wholly useless statements. None of them can be proven on your CV or your LinkedIn profile. How can you prove that you're any more or less enthusiastic than the other person who's just claimed to be enthusiastic? You can't, until you get face to face with somebody, and that's not the CV or the LinkedIn's purpose. The CV or LinkedIn purpose is to get you to the position where you're talking to somebody about an opportunity that you might be interested in, or somebody might be interested in for you. And so for that, you need to focus on what the requirements for the job are, the key skills that are required, and whatever, in an ideal world, whatever that recruiter or employer are actually looking for, and reflect that on your CV and profile. Now, the first thing, which, again, it's not particularly clever, but very few people do, and again, I challenge you to think about your own CV and LinkedIn profile, are you actually describing what on earth you are in the first place? So if you're a finance director, do you state that? If you're a financial controller, do you state that? If you're interested in payroll and have expertise in that, is that actually what's coming across on your CV, almost line one? And if it's not, but you're starting with some kind of random behavioral trait like enthusiasm, dedication, passion, commitment, what your career objective is, which actually isn't what the recruiter wants to hear about. They want to see how you'd fit into the role they've got on offer. They don't want to hear what your personal direction or objective is. So if you've got any of that, automatically you're starting off on the back foot. So our recommendation is make sure your profile states pretty clearly and quickly what you actually are, either generically or by specific title. Finance directors can get away with finance director because it's generically known. Everybody understands what one is. But if you've got an odd job title, and it is not really that well known outside of what you're doing right now or outside of your company, or you've had to take recently or at some stage in your career landing up to your most recent job a backward step. So let's, for example, say that you're a finance manager right now, but you were a finance director or a financial controller leading with finance manager, or having finance manager in your professional headline will automatically create a picture in the mind of your reader. If you're trying to push yourself back up to where you came from, you're automatically making it very difficult for yourself if you're stating something that isn't where you want to be. So you have to be very careful with the professional headline and also your summary on LinkedIn and your CV if you're in a position which isn't reflective of what you'd like to be doing. And that's typically a problem for people who've had to take a step back in their career or have got a very odd job title which doesn't mean anything to people outside your own business. So that's an area to be very, very wary of. So once you describe what you are, either generically or by title, if the title is by definition fairly generic, you need to describe what you actually do. And that tends to be the obvious things that the target audience is expecting to see for the job in hand, broadly speaking, and link that to what you're actually good at. So if it's payroll, yeah, what kind of software you're using, what kind of number of employees you're dealing with, yeah, do you look after the whole gamut as far as, you know, tax authorities and all the internal things and HR, or do you only look after specific elements? If you're an FD, what kind of size business have you been used to dealing with? Have you signed off on CapEx deals of certain size, mergers and acquisitions, due diligence? Talk about the things that you're good at, but most importantly, link them to what the target audience is expecting to see. Now, on the screen now is an example of a typical summary, which is not dissimilar from that which would appear on this individual CV, but importantly addresses all of the issues we've just talked about. Now, I won't read through this verbatim. You can see it for yourself. And one thing I'd stress, it doesn't matter what level you are. Whether you're a finance director, as this particular person is, or you just graduated and you're about to enter into your first job, it really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether you're in a a big business, small business, or your own business, everybody at any level, anywhere, can write something like this. The content, of course, differs, but the message is exactly the same. What are you? Experienced finance director in this case. What do you do? There's a list of things. Where can they add value? Well, it's principally this protecting cash flow and profitability, but it's also hinting at some of the bits and pieces. How long it is, again, varies enormously from person to person, but this is a pretty typical example of an opening statement that we'd write for somebody's LinkedIn profile. You'll notice that there's no reference to enthusiasm, dynamism, commitment, ability to work in a team or as an individual, giving 110%, or any of those behavioral traits that I mentioned. And I absolutely promise you, those kind of things will not do you any favors at all. So if you have them on your current CV, it is a very strong indicator that the CV is not the best that it could be by some margin. This kind of opening statement, adjusted, of course, to suit your own circumstances, automatically makes it far easier for the reader to determine that you're A, a valid applicant for the role in hand, that you would appear to have the appropriate skill set, and you're hinting at proof behind that, importantly. So if you get this right, and this bearing in mind, this is only the first part of either your CV or LinkedIn profile, you will make a substantial difference to whether anybody actually bothers to pick up the phone or send you an email saying, yeah, we should talk. And you'd be surprised how many people make that decision without going anywhere further through the CV. It's really quite interesting, or indeed LinkedIn profile. Most readers will probably want to just suss out where you currently are or what your most recent role was, but it's surprising how many people get selected for interview without somebody having read in detail the full CV or LinkedIn profile. And that can work for people as well as against people, I hasten to add. So for those that are lucky enough to get the interview based on a cursory glance at the CV, great, happy days. But for those people with an absolute gem of something lurking on page 3 or 4 of their CV, if that's where it currently is, you might get overlooked because most people don't read the whole document. They don't have time, particularly in the initial filtering stage of a job application, and even more so on LinkedIn, which for a lot of people is a verification of something they've seen already, i.e. your CV. And although increasingly people are being found purely on LinkedIn, again, it's a cursory glance, one of many that they might be looking at as far as profiles are concerned, before making a decision on which 5 or 6 maybe they should be meeting or having a phone conversation with. So this is the second thing. Get the summary sorted, and once again, you make a big difference to the style of the profile. Again, we look at Matt's example on screen, so it's the highlighted section. What's Matt doing? He's saying what he is, what he does, what his value proposition is, what he's good at. His profile actually goes a little bit beneath the screen, but there's no point in showing it because it's so unique to him. Most important thing is it deals with the key criteria. What it's not talking about is all of the behavioral skills that Matt does possess. You know, he's an engaging individual, he has enthusiasm, I guarantee you he gives 110% plus, blah, 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 but it's all irrelevant to mention on his CV and indeed his LinkedIn profile. It has no bearing on whether he'll get an interview or not. So make sure you don't have those things on your profile because they will harm you rather than help you. Okay, this next bit isn't actually one of the three things I'd say makes the material difference to your profile, but it's important to talk about. We'll come on to the third magic ingredient, if you like, very shortly. But of course, at some point, just as you have to do on your CV, you need to talk about the kind of experience that you've got, where you're currently working, where have you worked beforehand. But again, a common mistake that people make is that they dump what they've got on their CV into LinkedIn and just assume that that's going to be okay. And I'm afraid it isn't, because it can harm your prospects if you do that, because as I've indicated already, there's a chance your CV is not in a good place. So just replicating it doesn't help at all. In fact, it makes life worse. Note at the bottom, just as a reminder, as I've said a number of times, yeah, the strongest message I'd want to leave you with this evening is that you're creating this business case as to why somebody should consider hiring you. So hopefully you've got the general thrust of that now, which is it's a combination of what you've got to offer in your toolkit of skills, if you like, with what the target audience is expecting to see, and it's matching those two things. If you're sending your document, which is pretty much the same for all sorts of different jobs, that's not matching what your target audience is expecting to see, unless you're very lucky. Nearly everybody has different sets of requirements, so I'm afraid you do have to tweak the CV to reflect different job applications, even if they carry the same job title. You do sometimes have to change the content to better position your CV and profile for the audience and what they're expecting to see. Now, that's particularly true of the CV and the job application. It's slightly less true for the LinkedIn profile because you can't forever be tweaking around with that, in fairness. So it's important as another reason why your CV and LinkedIn profile ought not to be the same. You can't just dump one into t'other and then just leave it, because your target audience is expecting to see a specific message as far as your job application is concerned, which is the CV's job, by and large. And then when they go and check you out on LinkedIn, they want just to see a reaffirmation of the kind of message you've sent on your CV. So for that reason, dumping everything from your CV into LinkedIn doesn't work, and particularly this is true of the positions that you've had. And we recommend here you just provide a summary of the roles that you've had. You don't go into an enormous amount of detail, and you ought not to be having lists upon lists of bullet points with all the things that you've done in all the roles that you've had. People aren't interested in that. They just want to see a broad message that supports what they've seen elsewhere, or if they've not seen anything elsewhere, makes them think, well, this sounds about right. This person seems to be in the right space, doing the right kind of jobs. I'm intrigued. Let me find out more. You don't need to provide warts and all detail on your experience and positions within LinkedIn. And as with your CV, you need to have a balance between things that you've been paid to do in terms of your duties and responsibilities and the actual achievements that you personally have accomplished with those duties and responsibilities. And so there needs to be some focus, needs to be a balance between the two. And for those that have a career that goes back to the early noughties right now and beyond, don't put every single job that you've done. There's no obligation to list everything on LinkedIn. On the CV, it's a moot point. For some people, there's an argument that you could provide just a summary of the most recent time. Our view generally is to provide all detail on the CV. It's just you don't actually have to go into lots of detail for your earlier career. On LinkedIn, you certainly don't have to provide that. LinkedIn's more a snapshot of your abilities at a given moment in time, and you can be a lot more choosy about what you put on LinkedIn because nobody's expecting you to list everything. So if you've got a career that goes back to the 90s, 80s, and certainly the 70s, you ought not to have any reference to those dates on LinkedIn. It's only going to harm your chances. Whatever the legislation is in various countries these days, I'm afraid that if you advertise the fact that you had a career starting in the 70s, it is automatically going to be a problem for some people. They'll never admit it to you, of course, but it just happens, I'm afraid. So don't make life easy for people to dismiss you. Focus on the positive stuff. And for that reason, we say detail the last 8 to 10 years, or, depending on how many jobs you've had in that time, up to the last 4 jobs, as a broad indicator. Everybody's circumstances are different, but as a broad indicator, you don't really want to be providing lots of detail for anything longer than that. It won't matter. People are not going to select you for interview, in most cases, for work that went on, say, 15, 20, 25 years ago. That's just not where the market's at. People are going to expect you to be pretty much doing the job they're recruiting for or interested in right now, probably for a competitor, and that's what they're expecting to see. It's certainly not going to interest them to any great degree what you were doing in the 1990s or earlier. The third area out of the three that I said would make the biggest difference to getting your business case well positioned on your LinkedIn profile is actually a section that not many people know exists or don't use, and it's called projects. So let's take a look at what that is. So here's a profile. It's my profile this time. And this is the view you'd get if you were about to or in the process of editing your profile. So it's a slightly different view from when you're viewing somebody's profile or viewing your own profile as it appears to others. And you'll notice that on the far right-hand side, now indicated with the infamous red oval, is a section called Project. So this is where it typically appears. Depending on what you've already completed on your LinkedIn profile will depend on where this section actually appears on your own profile, but it will somewhere in this general area of the screen as you're editing your profile. And I'd recommend that you use this section to help build your business case. If you click on the Projects button that I'd earlier highlighted, it brings up a screen like this. And I'll show you a real life example shortly, but it's an area where it allows you to name an assignment, a project, an event, a happening, an achievement, if you like. Maybe view it as an achievement section as possibly the best way to relate to your CV if you're not used to LinkedIn. But you can give a number of projects a name, a separate name, and create a relationship between that event in your career and a job you actually had. So you see this highlighted area, there's a name. You have to give each project a name by default. So you can call it whatever you like, but of course it stands to reason you give it some kind of impactful headline that means something. The occupation area, there's a drop down, and so if you click on that, it will display all of the jobs you've entered up until that moment in time, and you can then link an achievement, a project, an event, an assignment with a particular job that you've had, which is quite useful. If you want to, you can date it. Now, we tend not to do that because dates can be dangerous for a variety of reasons, and you're not obliged to do it. And if you've got a website or some kind of online presence for this event, you can link it to exactly that, the website involving it. You can also, if you want to, allocate other people that were involved in the project. Most people don't, but it's technically possible. And then finally, you can add a description to the project, assignment, event, whatever it is, achievement, which describes what you were up to and what happened. Now, I'll show you a really nifty way very shortly of how you can make this section work and the kind of content that can go in it. But as I say, I'd guess that probably 3/4, if not more, of people online tonight will not have used the project section. And of that, the vast majority probably even didn't know the section existed. But as I say, it's probably one of the three areas that if you get right can materially improve your profile and therefore the chances of people noticing you and wanting to talk with you. There are some caveats which I'll come on to shortly, but that's the section. So you edit your profile, you look down the right-hand side, find the project section, click on it, it brings up this window, and then you enter away the information in a format that I will now explain. So the important thing, the caveat that I mentioned, if you're going to put anything on your LinkedIn profile of this ilk, you need to make sure that they're relevant projects or events or achievements. Now, some people say, well, yeah, big deal. No mystery to that. But again, you'd be surprised how many people on their CVs talk about wonderful things that they personally felt really excited about or proud of. And proud may well be the right emotion. But always bear in mind what the target audience is expecting to see. So, for example, let's say you were involved in some kind of financial analysis, and for those old enough to remember it, if your key project highlight, career highlight or project you wanted to highlight within LinkedIn or on your CV or anywhere for that matter, involved a time when you wrote a massive VisiCalc spreadsheet or Lotus 1-2-3 spreadsheet to do some complex analysis, whilst that's not the most hideous example that I've ever seen, it doesn't sit well with today's marketplace, most of which people won't know what VisiCalc is. And it's probably, I think it was the first spreadsheet run on Apple computers in the 70s and 80s. So a bit of an exaggeration, but we've seen things like that. Lotus 1-2-3, I don't think even exists now. If it does, not many people use it. Again, old spreadsheet. I suppose you could say, well, the principles are the same, but it just doesn't mark you down as being, you know, state-of-the-art person with all of the technological advantage at your disposal when Excel is the dominant spreadsheet. So get the relevance sorted. Make sure you're talking about things that are relevant to your target audience and that actually they would expect to see and would not be surprised at. Here's an example. Couple of things here that are important. One is the example itself, but also the methodology used to get at it. When we work with our clients, we, on the CV, pick out, generally speaking, three career highlights. We use a methodology to get to those highlights, which is called STAR, which is not revolutionary. Lots of people use this kind of acronym, and there are others with more or less letters in the acronym, but this one we use stands for situation, task, actions, and result. And the idea is you can take a complex event or happening and break it down into a few key stages and then reassemble it in a nice, concise manner. It's really useful for CVs, really useful for the project section on LinkedIn, and really useful for answering competency-based questions at interview if you're quick enough in the mind to be able to, or have rehearsed enough of these in your own mind to be able to repeat verbally. Now, some of you might already have read this paragraph on the screen, starting ERAC. ERAC stands for Enterprise Rent-A-Car. That's not important right now, but just so you know. And the first sentence of this paragraph is the situation regarding this project. So you can see Enterprise Rent-A-Car acquired an unprofitable competitor, and it needed sorting out, basically. That's the situation, the scene setter, the headline. It explains to anybody what the background to this event was. It happens to be off Matt Craven's CV, so it's a real-life example from his earlier career. The task that Matt had that rested on his shoulders was he was appointed operations manager to do a variety of things. The actions he took with that responsibility were perform top-to-bottom review of the business, blah-de-blah-de-blah-de-blah, right the way through to the last sentence, and the result is the last sentence, starting succeeded. And you can see that he succeeded in rebranding the business, achieving a certain level of profitability within a certain time scale. So that is a great example of how to take a complex event in his life, one that he saw as a big achievement, one that links on his CV, as it happens, to claims that he's made about his value proposition, what he's good at, the things that he thinks he could bring to another business if he were looking to move. And it provides that evidence to back up those claims. So remember the point I made earlier about how can you prove whether you're enthusiastic or more enthusiastic than anybody else? You can't. There's no way on God's earth you can write on your CV, I can prove that I was more enthusiastic, unless you took an enthusiastic test and somebody gave you a score of 93%, and you know that that was the highest score. You cannot prove that you're any more enthusiastic than anybody else until you get in front of somebody. And even then, it's not going to happen until probably you've worked for the business for 2 or 3 months. So it's pointless talking about it on your CV and your LinkedIn profile. What is far more constructive is to say, what are these people looking for? Have I got an example that might make them think, this is great. This is what we're looking for. We need somebody who can do this kind of thing in our business. We'll talk to them a little bit more about this. But it's a great example. It makes us feel warm and comfortable inside. We ought to interview this person. They seem to have the right stuff. So on LinkedIn, you pull out a few of these examples, write them in a nice, concise way that tells a story about your involvement in something that was relevant, what your position was, what the responsibilities were on your shoulders at that time, the things that you did, and the end result or conclusion as a consequence of you doing the things that you did. That's the evidence that backs up your business case. It's the strongest part of your business case because it's the proof. This really happened. This is the detail. Here we go. So that's the project section. So those are the three key things. I've talked about four sections, but the three key ones that make a difference are the professional headline, and aligning that to the core value you have to offer a prospective employer. The summary, by again reinforcing what are you, what are you good at, what is your value add to the world, and the projects in terms of the proof positive. Now, there's no rule on how many projects you need. Our view is probably, if you're in permanent work, 3 is strong enough. If you're a contractor, somewhere between 6 and 8 makes more sense because they can be linked to contracts that you've had. But that's a slightly different story. If there are any contractors on board, it's probably a separate discussion worth having because there are some unique things about being in contract world or interim world. But if you're in permanent employment, 3 strong projects or career highlights would suffice. And those 3 things done well will build and present your target audience with a far more effective business case as to why they should consider hiring you. So, just a brief interlude in terms of before showing you a few other bits and pieces you need to consider on your profile. I've mentioned already that we effectively do this work for some people. We write CVs and LinkedIn profiles from scratch. Now, if you're starting to think, and we'll cover this point very shortly, but most people fall into 3 camps. There's a bunch of people who think, well, I'm not going to do anything, and that's fine if you're getting enough interviews or if you think that you're in a place in the marketplace where you'll get the interviews and interest. That's absolutely fine. Most people need to probably do something, particularly if you're struggling to get interviews or you think you might struggle. And so then the decision are, well, do I do something myself or do I get somebody else to help me out? Now, if you start to think about that, just so you know, because most people ask these questions afterwards, so you can save the question being asked and you can leave a bit earlier. If we get involved in the process, you'll have probably gathered this isn't the work of a moment. You cannot sit down, write a LinkedIn profile in 2.5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, or even 30 minutes. It takes a lot longer than that. And just so you know, when we're working with our clients who come to us and say, look, do this for me, we have to spend a couple of hours normally with them extracting all the raw data just so that we're in a position to be able to then write their CV and or profile. And that's in addition to already having their CV, so it is a detailed process. And importantly, the process we're going through is to understand if they're heading in the right direction in the first place, and to clarify that, because some people are slightly misaligned in where they're trying to head and maybe don't appreciate that they're not going to quite get there without some either retraining or taking some further qualifications or whatever. So we have to clarify that where they're heading is the right place. We can then help define this infamous value proposition. So if you don't already know it, if you don't know where that value add that you have to offer is, we can help find it. And although to some people it's almost distasteful, you do have to view yourself as a brand, as a service, as a product to a marketplace, and we can help you position yourself for that and deal with that. And when we're working on the LinkedIn particularly, many of you might not be aware of the fact and are concerned genuinely about their privacy and people seeing their LinkedIn profile being amended or changed, whether we do it or you do it. But there is a facility where you can change and switch off that incessant flow of emails that you get from people who have changed something on their profile. Now, the reason why if you're getting those emails, you get them and why they annoy you is because most people don't know this facility exists and don't switch it off. So it doesn't have anything to do with your profile being visible or invisible, but it has everything to do with if you make a change, even to the spelling of your name or job title, then somebody will get an email somewhere saying, in fact, all your connections will get an email saying, Joe Bloggs has just changed their name or moved jobs or congratulate them on this or congratulate them on that. Now, you can switch off all of that if you want to, and then life becomes a little bit easier. You can busy away changing your profile and then switch it back on at some other stage, if at all. And of course, when we're updating our clients' profiles, that's exactly what we do. So it's a complex process and not to be underestimated. And if you go about this yourself, if you think it's the work of 5 or 10 minutes, then that's a bad indicator. I'm afraid it isn't. It's like most things, you have to sweat a bit to get it right. I promised some other considerations briefly before we wrap up. Remember I talked about a number of things on LinkedIn being offered to you by default, and that first, most people probably view that as being a help and an assistance and, you know, saves me a bit more time. Be very wary with some of the default settings. I've talked about one earlier this evening. The other one to be wary of is if you're ever connecting with anybody, and for those that have done this, you'll know you get a little window and it says, how do you know this person? Are you a friend? You know, a previous classmate? Have you worked with them, done business with them, blah, 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 and you have to select which one applies. And then there's a message by default, which words to the effect says, I'd like you to join me on LinkedIn, or I'd like to connect with you on LinkedIn. Make sure, if you can, erase that default message, because to the average person, particularly somebody you don't know that well, all that appears to is that you've taken the path of least resistance to them, and it implies a lack of attention. So take the time to write a personalized message that is unique to them, rather than just going with the default and hitting the send button. We've not talked about it much this evening because it's quite detailed. There is an area in LinkedIn called skills and expertise where you can enter up to 50 skills or areas of expertise that you possess. That is a really good area to use. It makes your profile easier to search for recruiters and employers, and ought to be part of a good profile. Obviously, it's highly personalized. If you know of the area, use it. Make the most of the 50 skills you're allowed. If you don't know of it, then seek it out or come to us and we'll point it out to you. Really important. If you have the opportunity to write recommendations for people, as long as they're genuine, do so. They help work back to you, raise your profile. If you're looking to, this is particularly relevant, if you're looking for a new job or new career or new career direction, and you want to add credibility, join groups that exist to support that area of interest of yours. If, let's say, for example, you had recently qualified, you've just moved into a particular area, let's say maybe statistical analysis of some sort, and you're making all the claims on your CV and you've got all the qualifications that are quite nice. Nothing detracts from your efforts worse than the impression that actually you can't be bothered with learning about your substance. So if you've just made a whole heap of claims about how passionate you are and interested you are about a particular field of work, on LinkedIn it's dead easy to recognize whether that's true or not, or perceived truth or not, because if you don't belong to any of the groups that exist to support that interest area of yours, guess what? It just appears that actually all you're talking about is a whole heap of waffle. So join groups that are directly relevant to your career objective, because they reinforce, whether you're actively participating in them or not doesn't matter the one jot. What it does do is create the impression to your reader that you are actively interested in the area that you've just spent some time claiming you're interested in. It can work against you, as I indicated. If you don't belong to groups and you claim to be interested in areas, it's a dead easy one for the canny interviewer to say, okay, you've talked about your interests, but you don't belong to any groups. Explain that. Difficult question to answer. Ditto, you don't have to on LinkedIn. I wouldn't suggest you have to get involved actively at all, necessarily. But it's not bad to participate in group discussions if you're trying to carve out a niche in a particular area, because again, it builds credibility. Where you can, from previous managers or people of authority, try and get recommendations. There's a lot of stats flying around about people being X number of times more likely, but the average seems to be about 3 times more likely to be picked up on and interviewed if you have been recommended by somebody that's credible. So not a mate down the pub, not a friend in the next village, or anybody from your peer group, but somebody who's managed you, employed you, recruited you. Very complex area. I won't go into a huge amount of detail. The general rule of thumb is photos tend to be a good thing to have, but I understand why some people might not want to have a photo. We've had plenty of feedback about that. Maybe a subject for the question and answer session in a minute if anybody's got any particular questions about photos. But the general rule of thumb is, unless you've got a good reason, probably a good idea to have a photo. For those that are aware of it, you'll notice when you're viewing your profile, LinkedIn will sometimes comment on its view of your profile strength. Don't get suckered into thinking the higher level of strength that you have, the better your profile must necessarily be. Give you a good example. If you've got a profile that's currently, let's say, average strength, and you add your photo, or I should say you add a photo to your profile, your profile will slightly be marked slightly higher. Now, the downside of all that is the photo could have been of a monkey. And of course, that's not really going to help your cause. So LinkedIn is not perfect. It scores your profile crudely based on the amount of content you hurl in its general direction, on the basis that the more content, the stronger your profile. That's not necessarily true. As I've probably indicated now this evening, the quality of the content is absolutely key. Whether you fill out all the boxes on LinkedIn is not the point. It's what you fill out in the most important areas that makes the biggest difference. So you don't need to put in all of your education. You don't need to tell people all about all the certifications and qualifications that you have. You don't need to tell people about all the schools you went to within that education. And you don't have to have a photograph necessarily. It's the content that you do have in the right sections that I've talked about this evening, done well, will make the biggest difference. Slightly more complex, but again, I can't go into lots of detail right now because we're running out of time. But for those of you who are aware, if you have a LinkedIn profile, you'll have a URL for that profile, which is normally a jumbled up list of numbers and letters all mashed up together. You can actually reset that to something more meaningful. You can type in one, and if it's still available, you can make it your own name or something more friendly. I'd recommend you do that. It makes it far easier to publish on your CV or to the wider viewing masses. And then finally, all of the sections on LinkedIn can be moved around. It's like drag and drop. Now, it won't be a surprise that the three sections that I spent most of this evening talking about are the ones that you should feature at the top of your profile. So if they're not currently in that order, I'd suggest you move them around. And that's possible with virtually all of the sections of LinkedIn. It is, as I say, drag and drop. And finally, the point at the bottom is quite relevant. I mentioned this earlier to those with good hearing, and that is the vast majority of people will check you out on LinkedIn. So if you make it to shortlist and they're thinking we're going to interview you, the vast majority of people in that position will then have a look at you on LinkedIn, either as part of the formal recruitment process or informally, just for their own interest, possibly even to figure out what you look like so they recognize you when you walk through the door. Therefore, it goes to say, hopefully, and prove the point, if your LinkedIn profile does not support the strength that got you the interview in the first place, there is a risk, and it does happen, there is a slight risk that you'll lose the interview chance. You won't know that you've got an interview necessarily yet, but you were virtually there and somebody looked at your profile and thought, don't like this. And it could be strong enough to give them a reason to reject your application right at the last moment. So treat it seriously and put the effort in to get it right. So what next? I mentioned decision time for some people. First decision anybody needs to make after having gone through this session is, do you need to do anything at all? And that could be with regards to your CV or LinkedIn. Remember right off I mentioned this acid test. If you're generally not getting enough interviews to make you happy and you're applying for jobs you know you can perform, or at least you believe you can perform, you've got a problem somewhere with the message you're sending. So then I'd be saying, okay, well, you need to make a second decision. And that is, you need to do something. Do you do it yourself or do you need help? Now, only you can make that decision. But for those that might be tempted by getting a third party, and I'd rather hope that would be us rather than anybody else to get involved, there's some great offers from ACCA available for a limited period of time. Two options, really. We can, in isolation, write a LinkedIn profile. Normal price, 150 quid. For people who've attended this webinar, discounted somewhat. It's quite a good offer, but the better offer is to get everything done in one go. We're having to talk with you, whether we do your LinkedIn profile or CV and LinkedIn profile, we have to talk with you for the same amount of time. So it makes sense to get that all done in one hit, to be truthful. So if you've not already had your CV sorted, and you're not convinced that it's doing the best job for you, by far the best option, best value option anyway, is to get your CV, LinkedIn profile, and a cover letter done for a price which is discounted quite heavily for people attending this webinar. So normally, that lot would cost you 379 plus VAT. and we're doing it for $299 plus VAT. That's only for ACCA webinar attendees. And for that, you get a couple of hours on the phone with one of our CV writers, complete restructure of your CV, the LinkedIn profile, and a cover letter for that price. Now, if you're interested in that, there's a place you have to go to take a look at the offer and process your order for those interested. I'm just going to sort of pausing there. I'm just going to paste that into the chat room so you've got it, because you can't click on the screen, which is where the same website appears. So you visit that site if you're interested, and it will take you to a page where you can place your order. We've done this now for a lot of people who are members of the ACCA. There's plenty of evidence on the various websites and ACCA contacts. If you've got any questions about the service, you can either ask them or ask us, contact us directly. But if it's something you're interested in, visit that website and we can then take care of you. As I say, we can write the LinkedIn profile on its own if you've got a decent CV already. It's just that it's not as good a deal in value terms, principally because all it's giving you is your LinkedIn profile. We still have to speak with you for the same amount of time to figure out where your value proposition is and your career highlights and achievements. That deal's available until week today, end of Monday 24th. If you've got any questions about it, by all means, take a view at our website. Give us a personalized email if you want to query the process. Look at our website, give us a call. The phone number's on our website. More than happy to help. And as I say, plenty of people from ACCA have been through this process and come out the other end. And it will materially make a difference to those that have struggled in the marketplace. Okay, that's the session over as far as the main content's concerned. So for those that need to go, you're more than welcome to. Thank you for your time. I hope you got something out of that. But if we can be of any help, please just give us a call or drop us an email. I promised I'd then take a look at any questions that have been asked. So if you just bear with me, I'm going to see what questions have been asked this evening and then just go through them one by one in order of those that have asked them. So just bear with me and I'll go through them. Deborah, if you're still on, will slides be available at the end of the webinar? Yes, sorry, I should have mentioned this. You'll automatically get a link tomorrow morning to a recording of this webinar so you can review the information again. Mohammed, unfortunately, has left the building, but he said to submit my CV but never get a call back. To anybody facing that circumstance, I guarantee the CV is the problem. There's some message on it that's a big problem. Masoom, ditto, slides, you'll get a link to this tomorrow. Jeff, do you have to add a photo of yourself to include? Oh, right, Jeff, hopefully by now, I know you asked that question before I got to it, but you probably have the answer. You don't have to add a photo. The reason why this is such a sensitive area is for like any other area that you could potentially be discriminated on, we have all sorts of feedback. The general rule of thumb is, as I said earlier, to have a photo probably is the wiser thing to do. But we've had all sorts of people say, well, what about this, what about that? And it could be down to appearances, ethnicity, age, any other means, sex with a small s. It's a really difficult area to give an absolute cast iron answer on, because we know on CVs, if you mention that you've got a career that started in the 70s, people could do the maths and work out that, you know, you're getting on a bit as far as they might be concerned, and therefore, do they really want that person in their business if they've got a policy of having, you know, 25 plus something or others floating around? Nobody will ever admit that to you face-to-face because it's technically not legal, but unfortunately it goes on. So what do you do? And so it's a very personal decision. So rule of thumb, have a photo. Any reason why you're suspicious of putting one on that might harm your chances, we'd respect that and understand it. I'd still say that there aren't as many people, that there isn't a tipping point yet, would be my observation. From looking at all the profiles I've seen, there's still a fair few without a photo. Rosalind, I've recently retired from full-time working, but would like a small part-time job. What would be best way to get this message across on LinkedIn? Really good question. So be yeah, honest, I mean, obviously in your case, Rosalind, it's something you entirely want to volunteer. So our view is always starts with build the business case. There's plenty of people out there looking for folk that could do part-time work or freelance work or odd hours, odd by not 9 to 5, 5 days a week. So our view would be get across the main message, which is the skills that you have. Why would somebody be interested in you in the first place? And then somewhere within the summary, probably, to have something that just explained the ideal circumstances that would fit your requirements time-wise, and be open about that, and no harm in that at all. Nidhi, please give an example of a professional headline of a graduate with no relevant experience. So devil's in the detail there. For anybody, that's a good question. For anybody who's got no real experience, what would your professional headline be? Well, it would be probably something reflecting on the direction you wanted to head. So it could be, depending on what your qualifications are, i.e. the subject of your degree, you could put a such and such degree, a such and such graduate looking to develop a career in such and such. So that wouldn't be a bad one. If you've got any extracurricular activity that links to your career objective, I'd try and cram that in. So for example, if you'd organized events or done some part-time work that might be relevant to where you want to head as far as your next career is concerned, that might be worth incorporating. But there's no harm in just summarizing the fact that you are a such and such graduate, i.e. subject-wise, looking to develop a career in, because you'll be up against other graduates who are also looking to do the same thing but won't state that, so it's differentiating still. Afnan, do gaps in your career or time spent unemployed affect an employer's recruitment decision? Well, Afnan, it's a very good question, and the reality is we'll probably never know for sure because nobody's going to tell you to your face. The reality is, from the feedback we get, is for some employers it will affect a decision, but normally the reason why it becomes a big deal is because the CV draws attention to the gaps of unemployment rather than focus on the business case as to why somebody should hire you. So most CVs we tend to see open up with, as I said earlier, a fairly generic, meaningless statement to start with, which doesn't help anybody's cause. So already the reader's thinking, here we go again. Then normally jump straight into education or possibly work experience. And if that's quite high up on page one of the CV or high up on your LinkedIn profile, and all it's saying is big gap here, unemployment there, then it just sets the wrong scene. What your CV and LinkedIn profile need to do above everything else is draw the reader's attention to why somebody should consider interviewing you or hiring you, but certainly interviewing you, before drawing their attention to your career history, particularly in your case if you've got spells of unemployment. Now, you have to accept, nobody, ourselves included, you can't change fact, and you can't win every battle out there, but you can win more battles if you present a more effective argument to your target audience. Now, I have to say, in most people's cases, that's not something that comes easy to people, and I genuinely say that. You know, most of the people we help have got a fairly fundamental problem. They've already tried to solve the problem, found it difficult, but that's because they don't know what to do, understandably. So we can help with that sort of thing. I'm afraid, as you've seen, it costs money, but then you have to decide whether that's a worthy cause to invest in or not. I can't make that decision for you. But build a business case first, then talk about your career history, and accept that you won't win all the battles, but you'll win more of them. Didi, could I get an example of a good accounts assistant profile? It's difficult, really, because it's part, as you might have gathered, Vidi, and anybody else still online, of which there are still quite a few, so I thank you for that. I hope you're getting the value out of these answers. As you probably gathered, it's such a personal thing. If there were a profile, a professional profile or professional headline you could write for everybody carrying the same title, then of course actually wouldn't be that good because everybody would look the same, and that's the problem. Most people go to market And they forget they're up against literally tens, if not hundreds, of competitors in the marketplace. Or if they don't forget it, they fail to see how they can be any different from those individuals. And the reality is, everybody out there is unique, of course, almost by definition. What most people don't do is spend the time trying to think how can they communicate, if not the uniqueness, at least some differentiation. What makes them slightly different? How can they present their message slightly differently from the vast majority of others? And crudely, all you need to do is get yourself into the upper quartile of job applicants. So you don't have to be number one, you don't even have to be number two, but you need to be in the upper 25% to stand a reasonable chance of getting selected for interview. Most people go to market without even giving that the merest thought. They just hurl their CV towards the employer or recruiter. They might have a LinkedIn profile backing it up, but if it's the same quality as their CV, as I've said earlier, probably not helping their cause, and then keep their fingers crossed and get all frustrated as to why they don't get interviewed. In most cases, it's not the recruiter or the employer, it's merely the message you've sent them, which has not compelled them to want to do anything. So we'd need to know a lot more before we could write a profile for you, Vinny, simply because there's probably other stuff lurking from your experience and background that we'd want to use in that profile. But at the very least, I can imagine it's got something to do with the work that you've done and that possibly you've been involved in some kind of analysis work, VAT work, HMRC work, payroll work, something we'd want to drag out of you that just demonstrates that you can give a return on the investment that someone's going to make in you. That's the way to look at it. So I'm sorry it's gone on a bit, but there is no custom, we don't like just pull a sentence out of a file which says accounts assistant, use this. It's bespoke to everybody, but it's going to be something to do with why is somebody going to pay you 25, 30, 45, whatever amount of money you believe you're worth. Why are they going to pay you that amount of money? What have you got to offer in return? It's hinged around that. I do apologize, but I've just seen that when I say this person's name, people will think we've elevated ourselves somewhat. But Madonna, believe it or not, Madonna, if you're still on, most of the talked about issues tonight are better suited for people that have already got a career. Fair point. What about a fresher? What would be contained in your CV and LinkedIn profile? How do you present a business case? Well, that's a really good question, Madonna, and in a way a fair one. The answer is, even if you've got no experience, most freshers, graduates, whatever, most people have got something lurking in their background which they perhaps have undervalued. So if I'm hoping, but it's not imperative, that you've got some work experience, a couple of months in summertime, doesn't matter, but you've probably got some experience from doing something outside of pure education, and it's surprising how much skill that might have given you. So for a lot of people, that could have been working in a fast food restaurant, handling money, handling different people, working odd and unsociable hours. All of those things give you competencies. So for a recent graduate, the focus is, of course, not on career highlights, projects, value propositions, blah, 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 because you've not proven them yet. What you have got to offer, hopefully, is competencies, proof of competencies. For graduate recruiters, they don't, of course, it's valuable to them if you've had a bit of experience. So you'll be up against graduates who have done something, either summertime work, part-time work, weekend work, whatever. We'd want to make as much of that as possible, not just to say you've done the work, but to say what competencies has that equipped you with that you could then convert into evidence and proof. So as I say, worked in a fast food restaurant, it's not just about I worked at a fast food restaurant, therefore you must employ me. It's about, as a consequence of that work, I have dealt with difficult people. I have dealt with money. I have possibly project managed on. Maybe you've organized an event at university and you had to project management or fundraise or generate interest or market or something. Anything we could grab hold of to say you have got skills that you've undervalued, convert them into what your target audience is expecting to see will make a difference. And that's how we'd approach it, Madonna. It's all about what you've got to offer your target audience, and your target audience is not expecting to find you have 10 years experience. Nidhi, as a graduate with no clear-cut career path, easy auditor management or financial account. Yeah, how do you create your LinkedIn profile to suit different target markets? Well, sort of, hopefully I've answered that one to some degree through Madonna's view. It's all about, okay, yeah, you haven't got the experience, understand that, you're not expected to, what have you got? And you just come back a level and say, it's all about the competences that you've probably explored in various experiences in your life. And think, okay, what's the target audience looking for? They're not looking for lots and lots of experience, they're looking for somebody with the right stuff. It's articulating that right stuff that you can prove on your LinkedIn profile and indeed the CV. What if you're a jack of all trades with a lot of all-round experience but not a specialist? How do you highlight that you can go in and start working anywhere, for example, rather than specialise? Another good question, really. Generally speaking, in today's world, we find most recruiters looking for people who, yes, they are perceived to be in the right space. So if you are a jack of all trades, you've got a number of choices. You either go to market with that broad approach and accept that there'll be a type of business that will value that, or you pick from all of those things that you've done, Azaz, and choose a focus for each particular application or type of application. So let's say crudely, there are plenty of people in IT and finance particularly who can wear a number of different hats. Now, some people will be successful because they target companies, maybe smaller companies, where being able to roll your sleeves up and do virtually everything is an absolute strength. And small businesses, interestingly, find it really difficult to recruit because they would like an all-rounder, somebody who's prepared to do everything and capable of doing lots of different things, but find it hard to recruit from bigger corporates because most people in the corporates work in silos, relatively speaking, and are specialists and therefore don't like to spread their wings and get involved in all sorts of other things. So part of it is down to who you're targeting. So if you were targeting the SME sector, for example, you could have a CV and a LinkedIn profile that said, look, I can do all these different things. Yeah, I'm real value to you, and they'd understand that message. If you took that message to the average corporate recruiter, a corporate employer, sorry, or organization, it might not work so well because they want somebody who's just a specialist in a given area. So then you have a choice. Have you got enough evidence to position your CV and LinkedIn profile at that area of specialism? And don't bother saying you're a jack of all trades. Forget all the frilly bits around the edges. Focus on one area or not. And that, again, that's a devil in the detail thing, but you have some choices you could make. Nadia, you said that you don't have to write about your jobs and experience, all your jobs and experience. How can you apply through for jobs in LinkedIn? Well, Nadia, again, devil's in the detail. It all depends what you've got to offer. And my comment really applies to people who've got a career more than 10 years old. And the reality is, most people will not be interviewed on the basis of what happened longer than that. So if your career is, let's say, 25 years old, certainly in detail, you don't want to be providing lots of detail for each of those jobs because that's not going to get you interviewed. However you apply, chances are you're still going to have to send a CV, which will explain some of the time. You just don't need to detail it all. So you don't need... We see so many CVs that still go on about a job 20 years ago where there's about 10 different things the person did. It's irrelevant. It makes no difference. So you might want a line that says you did a job from this date to that date with this company doing this function, end of, literally that simple, and detail the stuff of the last 8 to 10 years, roughly. So that's broadly what I mean. It's not so much about... We're not advocating people remove chunks of their history necessarily, but on LinkedIn there's no obligation for you to put all that detail. It's a personal choice. It's something we work with our clients to decide what's best for their message. Do we list everything but only lines for anything more than 10 years old, or do we miss chunks off because it's not helping their cause, particularly if they've got an earlier career in a completely unrelated subject? It's a personal decision. But as a broad indicator, only detail the last 8 to 10 years. Anything before then, if you're going to put it, just have a line. People might want to ask you about it later, but they're not going to select you for interview on the basis of what happened that long ago. Thank you, Deborah, to your thank you. Jacob, I am not looking for a job at the moment. Is it necessary to do my CV in preparation for the future or wait until I am ready? That's a really good question, Jacob. I mean, the mercenary part of me says, you need your CV writing tomorrow morning. I'm only joking. But it is a good question. It depends on that time horizon. Interestingly, we get a chunk of people, and it is again finance and IT people by and large, particularly IT contractors, who will get the work done in anticipation, because they're treating themselves more like a business. The IT contractors particularly see themselves as being, you know, almost like a mini business, which in effect they are. So they have a whole different mindset on it. I think it all depends on the lead time, Jake. If you're thinking not necessarily for another 12 months or so, in fairness, quite a lot could happen in 12 months, and therefore it's probably a bit ambitious to start out on the crusade right now. But if you're thinking it could be anywhere in the 0 to 6 month horizon, give or take, probably not a bad idea to start getting things ready. Interestingly, this is only for a few people, but if for those people that are interested in the service, but almost like want to pre-book it, I mean, there's nothing to stop it. There's no pressure from us. If people order the service and say, I'd like to buy it now, secure it, and get it at this price, when you take advantage of it, it's entirely your business. Most people we work with within a sort of a 7 to 10 day horizon, but we've had some people who buy it and then not come back to us for 12 months. So it's technically possible to do that if you wanted to. But I think the serious side of it, Jacob, is that, yeah, if you think it's 0 to 6 months, probably worth thinking about now and starting to prepare for it. Particularly if only because you're building a presence in the marketplace, and the more people you expose yourself to in the nicest possible way, the more people get to figure out what you're about, see you, are aware of you, particularly on LinkedIn, and then when you're ready to press the button, it's not like a big surprise to everybody. That's a bit over-exaggerated, but hopefully you get the point. Possibly, if you want to take that offline and talk and approach us directly, Jake, we'll have a more detailed conversation about that. But that would be my general advice. Deborah just turned a certain age. Is age important in getting a job? I don't feel old. Okay, that's another good question. Assuming you're based in the UK, Deborah, we see all sorts. Sadly, we do see the side where age still seems to matter, despite the fact that it's technically illegal or against all employment law anyway. So it all depends. It depends on so many things. For those people who've got particular skills, it doesn't seem to matter so much. For people who are targeting certain markets where there just doesn't seem to be a bother about anything other than what's important, i.e. the skills at hand, doesn't seem to be an issue. But we know there are some employers out there who brief recruiters to go out and look for a certain type of person, and there's not a lot you can do about that, because that will all come out in the wash at some point in time. So it could be technically possible. You could vault all the hurdles until finally meeting somebody, and ultimately you could get well past that stage and somebody actually physically, you know, sees you filling out an application form where you're forced to put in your date of birth. Now, we don't know. I can't prove that anything changes, but you know, from the feedback we get from some people, it does make a difference, age, unfortunately. Our view is the only thing you can do is, A, you know, behave in the way that you seem to be, which is, you know, doesn't matter. And importantly, from a personal point of view, just get across the good things that you've got skill-wise, and just accept that those people that are bothered about it, well, stuff them in the nicest possible way. Probably not worth working for. Jacob, can you tell me what I need to do to improve my profile if I subscribe for the CV and LinkedIn assistance? Not quite sure what you mean there, Jacob. Maybe just clarify a bit whilst I try and answer what I think you mean. So if you went with the service, we do a lot of the legwork to in effect help build what you need to do, your business case, your message. We can do all that. All you need to do is be able to answer our questions and be a willing participative contributor to that very message. Now, in our experience, everybody's got a good story to tell. They just don't realize it some of the time. So we know how to extract all the raw data we need from you. Obviously, the missing bit is, what are you trying to do and with what kind of people? So it's the type of jobs that you're looking to go for and the kind of companies those jobs might be with. That's the bit that we obviously don't have any knowledge about whatsoever. Once we know that and combine that with a conversation about you, we can extract all the relevant data, which says, okay, well, this kind of audience is likely to be looking for this kind of proof. We extract that proof from you and then articulate it in a way that will build your profile. AMA, must projects always link to a job, or if it's relevant to the job, can you linking to extracurricular activity? That's a good question. No, the projects don't have to be linked to a job. So they can just be project achievements. This is on the LinkedIn profile, which I highlighted. They don't have to be linked to a job. They could be linked to other activity, as you suggest. So they could appear floating, if you like, in your LinkedIn profile. Meduzi, if you have been in non-profit service industry and you want to change industry production industry to industry, strike production industry, how can you show that you can do the job for a prospective employer industry? Oh, that's a really good question. And generally speaking, for anybody looking to switch emphasis, so this is broadly a public sector, private sector transfer. Anybody trying to do that, particularly public to private, it is a challenge. Now, again, Zuzi, the only thing I can say here, we'd have to dig a bit deeper, but it's technically possible to do to build the business case. So as long as you've got something we can draw on to say, okay, well, you've got transferable skills, we can bring all that to the fore. But again, as I said to one of the earlier questioners, you will not win all the battles, because there will be some people out there who will just assume, whether it's right or wrong, doesn't matter. We just know that they'll assume that because you've come from a non-profit organization, it would be difficult for you to adapt to a more commercial industry. And that might be true, it might not be true. We'll probably never know, but we just know that assumption goes on. So the best you can do is to build a strong business case as to why somebody should be interested in you for what you have to offer, and accept that there'll be a proportion of that audience that won't buy it. They just won't accept it. But there'll be a proportion who say, okay, maybe we'd give this guy a chance. Maybe, yeah, there's enough evidence here to make us think, well, at least they've taken the time to position themselves well for our kind of environment. Maybe we should meet up with them and take a view. That's probably the best answer I can give. Deborah's left the building. Thanks. That's okay. So she's thanking for time. Gabriella, we're almost at the end now, actually. So anybody's asked a question towards the end, I'm almost with you. Gabriella, I have worked in accountancy for almost 2 years, but after that I have been doing another job. So there is a gap. How should I write that up? Okay, so if I've understood that well, Gabriella, so you've been in accountancy, then done something else, and presumably want to get back into accountancy. If you do, then again, best case is you build a business case. So on the CV and the LinkedIn profile, you need to be talking about the good skills that you've got that are relevant to what you want to do next. Accept that there is a gap. Be honest about that. You've been doing something else. You can't change that. It is what it is. But when you mention that, this is where most people go wrong. They mention it way too early on the CV and LinkedIn profile. You can't change it, and we'd never condone that anyway. But you can delay the moment at which you're communicating the least helpful bit of information, if that makes sense. So focus on all the good stuff, the fact that you have got experience. If you have got career highlights, if you've got enough to draw out the career highlights, get them onto the CV and the LinkedIn profile. So they're all reinforcing the fact that somebody looking at your CV and application will be thinking, okay, this looks relevant, this looks interesting, here's the proof to back it up. This person seems to be in the right space. So by the time they get to the what are you doing right now or have been doing most recently, the sting's taken out of it a bit. There will always be people who will possibly look at it and say, yeah, but they're not doing what I'm expecting them to be doing right now. There will always be people like that. And some of them might give you the benefit of the doubt, and some might just say, no, I need somebody who's doing it right now. for one of my competitors kind of a view. You can't change that. You never will be able to change that. So, except again, you'll win some more of the battles by getting the presentation more effective, but not all of them. Uga Chukwu, and I hope, apologies if I've not pronounced your name correctly. Do you have career-specific profile writers, product control for investment banks, or risk? And yes, to an extent we do. I mean, I can't hand on heart, I can't tell you that we've got experts in every field. Otherwise, to be honest, they'd be out doing those exact same jobs and probably getting paid a damn sight more as a consequence. But we've got a team of writers, about 10 or 12 writers right now, and they all have areas of specialism. Half of them focus on accounting, roughly, because we've done a lot of work with ACCA, and of that, funnily enough, Matt Craven, the guy that set up our business, he worked for UBS Investment Banking. You might have seen that on his LinkedIn profile if you were particularly eagle-eyed within his sort of opening summary bit. We've got a couple of other people who've worked in senior positions within finance and accounting. So actually, we do have quite a high level of expertise, more than a lot of people give us credit for sometimes. But yeah, we're not experts in every nuance. The most important thing that we're good at is we know how to take somebody's message as it stands right now and convert that into a wholly more compelling document, and that's the important skill. Yes, we know the terminology and who are the big players in the industry, so we know enough about what's important as far as the terminology you might hurl in our general direction, but the most important thing is we know what works in the marketplace. We know how to get that message right. Nadia, how can you tailor your profile to different jobs? You have to change it all the time. Good question, Nadia. Not necessarily. Certainly not the LinkedIn profile, because that is impractical. And also, of course, LinkedIn profile is visible to lots of people at any one time. And it's not like a CV. A CV is like a laser-guided missile, really. It should be super precise. Always tweaked for the application in question, because by the time anybody's figured out you've got a number of different versions of your CV lying around, it won't matter. You'll be judged on the CV you put in for that particular application at that moment in time. Whether you've got 25 versions of it, 2 versions, or 2,000 versions, it really doesn't matter. All that will happen is your latest version will overwrite any earlier versions, and the turnover amongst recruiters, all the different recruiters you've probably dealt with, all the different job boards, and the impersonality of the whole industry to some degree, won't matter how many versions of your CVs flying around, as long as you send the most appropriate one to any specific application. So that's that side. On LinkedIn, you can't do that, of course, because you'll be forever playing around with it. So you've got to, that's why you can't dump your CV into LinkedIn. Your LinkedIn's got to be a subtly different message, and it's got to be with that broader audience in mind. It doesn't have to be as laser focused. Don't expect people to look at it and just think, oh, it's exactly as they say on the CV, and if it's not, that's a problem. My comment about the differences are fundamental differences, like, yeah, this person said they were doing this job from May 1998 to April 2013 on one document, and on the profile it says completely different dates from that. That's the kind of problem you've got. Stating a broader message on LinkedIn, not a problem, as long as it doesn't conflict with what you're sending on your CV or job application. So, as far as your LinkedIn profile is concerned, you don't have to be forever changing it. You just need to make sure that its broad message is supportive of any application you're likely to make. And that's perfectly acceptable. Chris, very nearly end now, so for those that have been desperately hanging on for an answer to their question, I'm almost with you. Chris, can we pick and choose which past positions to include in LinkedIn? Will the gaps between jobs in this case cause problems? That's a good question, Chris. If I read that rightly, let's say you've got 10 jobs, you want to pick 5 out to focus on, which would create gaps. That is a good question. It depends how much detail you put. If you, and one thing I'm just trying to think, if you're obliged to put in dates And I, hand on heart, Chris, right now I can't remember whether you're forced to have to put dates or whether it's optional for your career bit, because it's been a while since I did a LinkedIn profile manually. So let's assume if you had to put the dates in, I think it'd be a problem. You've got to be a bit careful about that because the gaps would look odd. So I'd say probably not a good idea. If you were not forced to put in the dates, you could probably get away with it. It depends on the message you want to say. So I'd say be wary with that one in any case, but it might technically be possible. I just think there are probably better ways of getting across your particular message. My view on that would be probably that if you are seriously going down that route, maybe talk to us beforehand separately and we'll take a look at it in a bit more detail to see what you're trying to communicate, which bits you're trying to pick out from your background and for what reasons. There might be a more constructive way around it. Masoom, do you, very good question actually, and just to prove that I answer all of them, good and bad, do you offer a money-back guarantee if one doesn't get a job? That is a grey area, Masoom, but a very good and fair question. Technically, no is the honest answer, not just matter of fact, and very few people do. If you read the small print, there are some writers out there who say that they do, until you read the small print and you realise that you've got to have jumped through a fire-ringed hoop, stood on one leg for 3 hours, and then juggled 7 hamsters in mid-air, and then you'll get a refund. And I exaggerate to make a point. But most people who claim to offer any money back will require all sorts of evidence and proof and all sorts of God knows what before they will hand their money back. The harsh reality is nobody can guarantee anything, of course. All we can do is say, you know, I can guarantee you, you'll get a better result not having seen your CV, but I've yet to see a CV. We've not been able to improve. And in fairness, most people who go to market find a material difference. So that bit's assured. What we would do is we have sometimes encountered people with particularly difficult circumstances, and we probably, if we really thought we couldn't help, we probably wouldn't go down the route of taking the money in the first place. It's probably a more realistic way of looking at it, and we sometimes have to be that harsh. You know, we are not miracle workers. If you are a supermarket checkout operator and you want to become a nuclear submarine captain, it doesn't matter what we put on paper, it's not going to help. So there are all sorts of, you can see the grey areas now. So we take a look at the situation first. We take a look at people's CVs. We try and figure out what they're trying to do before we take their money. So if you signed up tonight, for example, and said, right, I'm going to go with the deal, if we saw your CV and message, we'd probably say to you before we started, Masoom, look, this is just not going to happen. Best be honest about it. Let's not move forward. Here's your money back. Rather than we just write your CV and then you tell us you've not become a nuclear submarine captain and having to give your money back. So if that helps, we try and nip it in the bud rather than facing a problem further on down the road. For those people that do use our services, one thing I can guarantee you is that they get a material increase in the level of activity behind their job applications. But we won't entertain people we don't think are realistic about their objective. Salman, I'm an ACCA qualified, but I am AAC qualified, but lacking in IT skills such as SAP, which stops me getting a job. How can I overcome this problem? Okay, well, if that's, again, not knowing the kind of jobs you're going for, Salman, I'm assuming that SAP is very high up the list of desirables for whoever your employer is. And obviously, that's a good example, linked to what Masoom's saying. If it really is a case that you have to have that level of technical ability before you're going to get a job in the area that you're exposed to, then it sort of points to the fact that somehow you've got to get that experience. Now, I don't know much about SAP in terms of whether you can take any accreditations, a bit like you can with Microsoft stuff. But if that were the only route, then it sort of points where you have to go. However, I suspect there's ways into this, and there's probably stuff that you've got which, if you just targeted the right kind of people and the right level, you may find be able to make a reason as to why you'd be able to get into a particular employer who runs SAP into a role that the requirement is not so much that you have to have used it, but you'd be willing to learn and have the right competences to be able to learn and start at a particular level and build your way up, and then we position the CV accordingly. So again, devil's in the detail, really. There are some jobs where you have to have certain things, and it's black and white, and you can't progress without them. And then that's a question of either you backstep a bit on your career objective, or you take training to give you the level of ability that somebody is demanding of you. Now, I don't know what applies to you, but my suspicion is it may be a bit of both. And so we'd want to just make sure you've got to document that positions you well to get a job that gets you exposure to, from which you can then build. And if that's acceptable to you, we can probably help. Gabriella, you said yes to something which I can't remember what the question was. But you also thanked me, so I'm assuming that our job's done. Amir, took a career break to complete my ACCA. Now it's done. What is the best way to get back into work, and how to depict that on CV and LinkedIn? Amir, it depends what your career break was for. To complete my ACCA. So that is the best. Sorry, yeah. So that's pretty good. I mean, anybody who's taken time out to train and achieve a level of qualification, that's a pretty good thing. So I'd be open and honest about it. We often deal with people who've taken time out and they've done other things, and those other things can sometimes be wholly irrelevant to their future, but in a lot of cases are semi-relevant or totally irrelevant. Now, yours is totally relevant. You've taken time out. You've got your qualifications. That's a good thing. Make something of it. Obviously, again, we need to know what level you were trying to target and what kind of organizations, but I'd say, you know, that's be honest about that. It's a good productive reason why you've taken the time out. So now you can complete a bit about what your career's been about, the fact that then that allowed you to do your ACCA qualifications. Now you're ready to hit the market, and just be open and honest about it. Assume, does LinkedIn offer you to be the only available to LinkedIn users, not to search engines? Yes, there is buried deep in some of the settings an ability to make you visible or not to other search engines, assume. So yes, there is. And in answer to your second question, can you see who's viewed your profile? Yes, you can, to a limited degree, depending on your membership. Yes to both of those. They're deep in the settings, as a more complex answer required there. But yes, if you fiddle around with the profile, there is a setting for both of those things, and you can see who's viewed your profile. LinkedIn will actually give you some feedback on that occasionally. You get an email saying, see who's looked at your profile. If you've got a premium account, then that's far more accessible. Nadia. Last question. When tailoring CV, which part of CV do you actually change or modify? Oh, that's a really good question, Adit. So it depends. On the CV, our CVs have three critical sections. One is the opening summary, a bit like that I described this evening for LinkedIn. So it's like a paragraph about what you are, what's your value proposition, i.e. the core thing that you can do that is justifying why somebody should pay you money, some things you're good at, all aligned to whatever the target audience is looking for. So by implication, that opening statement should change subtly, not necessarily for every job, but you need to make sure it's relevant to your target audience every time and not saying something that's contradictory or not helping your cause. Then we have an area which is like bullet points of key skills, which is good for search engines, because we use phrases and words that people tend to search for, but visually it looks good as well, because it just reaffirms things like HMRC liaison, or VAT office, or VAT return responsibility, or Microsoft Excel advanced user. Yeah, those kind of functional things that are easy to quote in three or four words, that would be changed, because often employers and recruiters will say, we're looking for skills in certain areas. So you can reflect those skills back on your CV, so that could be customized. And then finally, the career highlight section, so the projects that I talked about this evening on LinkedIn, these sort of paragraphs using the STAR criteria, so events or happenings in your life that you're yes, proud of, but are relevant to your target audience. Again, we tend to have three examples of those on the CV. most people are targeting jobs where those three examples could remain the same, but you just need to make sure they're relevant to your target audience, and if they're not, you pick a better example or examples to meet their needs. So that potentially is a third area that could change. The rest of the CV is pretty traditional in the sense you've got your career history, positions, your education, personal details, blah, 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 blah. Now, that by and large stays the same. So there are three areas, interestingly, all three of them on the first page of the CVs that we write, that you could tweak either substantially or not so substantially, depending on who you're sending your CV to. Thank you, Madonna, and thank you, Masoom. And that is the last question. And so that's it. Unless there are any very final questions, I'll keep on line for another 30 seconds or so. But to all of you that hung on, I admire your stamina. I hope you got something out of it. Otherwise, I've just ruined your Monday night. And I much appreciate your contribution and your questions. As I say, anything we can help with, contact us. And in the meantime, I wish you all good night. Best of luck going forwards. But if we can be of any help, you know where we are. And so good night to you all. And I'll hang on for another 15 seconds or so, and then I'll shut this thing down, and it'll all disappear in front of your very eyes. Good night to you all.